Like I said before, it's an old lock. You should get it checked out. Anyway, it's probably just shrubs scraping against the window.
No, it wasn't like that. Both times it was a screeching sound, like someone's scraping their fingernails across the blackboard. Did you check outside?
Yes, like the first time you called, no sign of anyone.
I know someone was trying to get in. It wasn't just the wind. I'm not an idiot. I know what I heard.
Living alone, you know, windy nights, things rattle. It's easy to get all kinds of things in your head. We get lots of calls from lonely women.
I'm not lonely.
Look, if I was you, just go back inside, put the music on, and just take your mind off the wind.
Defendant then made admissions relating to the death of his partner, Joshua Green. He was charged with the offence of murder, bail was refused, and he will remain in custody until his appearance in court. Did I leave anything out?
Thanks.
I'll drop you home.
Okay. Oh, no.
You two look like hell.
Not enough hours in the day, sir.
That's not a plug for overtime.
If it is, would I get it?
Nope. Victim's name? Elizabeth Mallow. Age 25.
Father?
Maria Mahoney, the cleaner.
Morning.
Morning.
What have you got for us, Fisk?
Well, the two broken fingernails. However, there is something under the index fingernail of the right hand. It's too dark for skin. Some other substance.
Yes, I'll see you get a scraping at the autopsy, Lance.
Imogen.
Any idea how she died, Toots?
Yes, possible strangulation, judging by the contusions to the neck and the hemorrhaging to the eyes. Circular bruising indicates that it was manual.
Right.
Sexual assault.
Given the bruising to the genital area, I'd say there's every probability.
This how the killer got in, Fisk?
Yes, that lock's been forced from the outside. Also, there are scratches on the glass there. The killer has definitely entered and exited through that window.
Do you have an approximate time of death?
Yes, you're looking at sometime before 2 a.m. She's been dead 6 to 8 hours.
Sergeant, I'm finished in here. You want me to whip outside?
Yes, whip out and I'll join you, Constable.
Cleaner let herself in at 8, found the body and called the local police.
So was the front door open, unlocked, when you came in this morning, Mrs. Broad?
I have a key. The door was locked, as it always is. Elizabeth was very careful about things like that.
And did you touch anything when you came in?
I put the kettle on. I usually like to have a cup of tea before I start work.
Mm-hmm.
As I waited for the water to boil, I went to Elizabeth's bedroom. I like to air the flat while I work. Her door was closed. I found her on the bed. First, I thought she had slept in, just didn't see me. I'm a heavy sleeper myself. Could sleep through an earthquake, my little boy says.
And how long have you been Miss Mallow's cleaner?
I'm not a cleaner. I am a manager. Something goes wrong with the flats, they call me and I see about the maintenance. I helped Elizabeth out now and then, that's all.
How long have you helped her out?
2 years. Sweet girl. Very polite. Worked very hard in real estate. Said she wanted to make it to the top.
What I wouldn't give for a cigarette. Been on duty 15 hours straight. I was just about to knock off when we got this call. Could have knocked me over with a feather.
Right.
This your first homicide?
No, the victim called me and my partner in twice last night.
She what?
Yeah, she reported a prowler outside her bedroom window.
Hang on. You're telling me you were here last night twice?
9:15 and then at 11. But we checked the place out thoroughly. I mean, there was no sign of anyone. We checked it out inside and out.
What about the bedroom window?
The lock was faulty. It rattled in the wind. I told her she should get it checked out.
Great. I don't suppose you suggested to her she should go and stay with a friend or someone can come and stay with her.
She just needed reassurance. That's what I gave her. She was the hysterical type, easily spooked, you know.
Look, Constable, Elizabeth Mallow is dead, strangled. I think she had every right to be hysterical, don't you?
I'm going to have a look outside.
Righto.
It was only a partial footprint, unfortunately.
Could have been one of the local constables. They were scratching around here last night.
Why were they doing that?
Elizabeth Mallow called them twice before she was murdered. She reported a scratching sound on the window, but there was no indication anyone had been around.
Well, the third time there was. Why didn't she call then?
Well, maybe she didn't hear anything on the third time.
Still doesn't make the local boys look good, does it? I'll get on to their commander about that.
Right.
Listen, you two, check out around the back.
Okay.
I wouldn't want to be in that constable's shoes.
Me either. I wonder why Elizabeth Mallow didn't call the police on the third time.
Well, maybe she didn't get a chance to. Or maybe she didn't want to look stupid in case it wasn't her false alarm.
Oh, come on. Fear is a much stronger emotion than embarrassment.
No, not always.
What? You'd rather face a murderer and look stupid than admit it was a false alarm?
No, but I have a gun and I'm assuming Elizabeth Mallow didn't.
Look, Constable Panay looked in here and they said they didn't find anything, no?
Maybe they were afraid of spiders and didn't look closely enough.
Yeah, well, more likely just sloppy police work. Yeah. Come on, let's go. I'm Detective Steve Hayden from Homicide. May I have a word to you?
Hi, Paul Holmes!
Sit. I hope you're not one of these mumbling types. I don't hear so well as I used to. And you young people speak English like it was a second language.
Did you know Elizabeth Mallow well, Mrs. Beattie?
There's no need to shout. I'm not that deaf. And call me Mrs. B, everyone else does. Look, I warned them all. I told them something would happen if those shrubs weren't cut back. Anybody could hide in there and you'd never know.
Do you know anyone who might want to kill Elizabeth Mallow, Mrs. B?
No. Nice girl. Always a smile. Always a hello. She didn't have much time to chat, though. Rush, rush, rush. I kept telling her, slow down. There are more things in life than work. And why she never married young Pete, I'll never know.
Pete? Mrs. B?
Peter Poole. Elizabeth's boyfriend. They live together. Oh, poor boy. He must be heartbroken.
He's not living there now, Mrs. B.
But of course he is. I should know. He brings in my racing guide nearly every Wednesday. He comes in for a cuppa. He leaves work earlier than Elizabeth, and he fills in a bit of time with me until she gets home. Both like a bit of a flutter.
This Mr. Poole, do you know where he works?
Well, he's a salesman of some sort. I mean, he doesn't know.
Mrs. B, did you hear any noises last night? About 11 o'clock?
No, never heard a thing. I'll tell you who might know where Pete works. Sonia Cameron. She lives upstairs in number 3. She's a friend of Elizabeth's. They work together. Best of friends, like most opposites, I suppose. Pete should have told me he'd moved.
Are you sure it's Elizabeth?
I'm afraid so. Were you home last night, Mr. Gunter?
Up until 11:20, that's when I leave for work. I'm the night manager at St. Martin's Hotel, midnight to 7.
Right, and you didn't notice anyone hanging around the flats when you left for work last night?
No, but I did hear someone downstairs at about 11. Voices, but I didn't take much notice. Poor Elizabeth, I can't believe it.
What about 9 o'clock last night? Did you see or hear anyone then?
No, I was on the phone. I ring my mother's doctor that time every night and she lives up north and she never tells me how she's doing, so I give him a call.
Could you give me his number, please? We really need to check everything. Thanks. So did you know Elizabeth well?
Well, not that well. She was nice. We had drinks together a couple of times. I know her boyfriend moved out a couple of weeks ago, but apart from that...
Her boyfriend?
Peter Poole, arrogant sort of bloke. Always thought he was better than everyone else. Although he was jealous of me having a drink with Elizabeth. Although Sonia next door, she'd know more about that. But she'd be at work by now.
My God, what are you telling me? Where have they taken her?
You can't go in there, mates. We have to keep it secured. The homicide are finished with it. It's a crime scene.
Mr. Poole?
What am I going to do, Vic? Elizabeth can't be dead.
Whoa.
She can't.
You two know each other?
He's my brother-in-law.
Mr. Poole, your brother-in-law, Constable Panay.
Vic? Yeah, he's married to my sister.
Did he know Elizabeth?
Yeah, he'd met her.
I would have been there to look
back
out.
Back off!
Throw away the kid!
Back off!
Sonia Cameron, he killed her. He killed my best friend.
She should never have let Peter move in with her. I warned her. He was a pig. She should have got rid of him earlier.
So she didn't own the flat with Peter?
They get the money. He was a second-rate salesman. Elizabeth earned 3 times as much as he did. Another thing for him to be jealous about.
I should have been there. If I'd been there, this wouldn't have happened.
Well, maybe. When did you move out of Elizabeth Mallow's flat, Peter?
2 weeks ago.
Why?
I'd had enough.
Of what?
I hardly ever saw her. She was too wrapped up in her work. Dinner with clients and working every weekend. And she was becoming neurotic.
In what way neurotic?
Nervy. Jumpy always. Snapping at me.
He was always accusing her of playing around. I mean, she wasn't like that. Elizabeth never looked at another man. I mean, men were attracted to her. Of course, she's beautiful. Successful, fun. Men were always making passes, but she never played around, no matter what he might tell you.
What were you doing back at the flat today, Peter?
I'd left some things behind. I wanted to get them back. I knew Elizabeth would be at work. I didn't want a scene, you know?
How did you plan to get in? Did you keep a key to the flat after you moved out?
I would have asked the cleaner, Maria, to let me in.
Right. Where were you last night?
I went out for dinner by myself. And then I went for a walk. I was back home by 10:30. I didn't go out again.
Can anyone confirm that?
Why don't you check where Sonia Cameron was?
Elizabeth left work around 7:15 last night. We were going to see a movie together, but she said she was sick, so I went on my own. I should have gone home instead, maybe.
What time did you get home?
About midnight.
And did you notice anyone when you got home? A strange car parked? Did you try to find out how she was?
No, she let me down.
But she was ill.
Elizabeth got a headache every time she had to deal with something emotional.
And she was emotional last night?
Apparently. I don't know, it was very complicated.
How long had you known Elizabeth?
3 years. I told her about the flat being for sale. It was a goodbye. She'd almost paid it off, too.
You said before that she should have got rid of her boyfriend, Peter, earlier. Why?
I thought you knew. I mean, you have arrested him, haven't you?
No, we haven't arrested anyone yet.
Peter found Elizabeth having a drink with Ian Gunther, from upstairs. They were just having a drink, for God's sake, and Peter beat her up. I told her to get rid of him. They only have to hit a woman once. Once. That's just the start of it. A passion never changes. They just get worse.
She suffered severe bruising to her upper arms, but not on the night she was murdered. I'd estimate they're a couple of weeks old. Several more bruises to the torso, also a couple of weeks old.
That confirms Sonia's accusation that Peter Poole was violent.
As to the night of her death, she was sexually assaulted, but there's no trace of semen.
Ooh, could the killer have used a condom?
Deeper bruising internally would suggest that the penetration wasn't penile. More than likely, it was manual.
So far, we've got two people accusing each other of murder.
What about motive?
Nothing yet.
The nature of the assault could indicate that the killer was sexually dysfunctional. Now, he may have broken into the flat with the intention of raping her, but could not perform.
Someone like an ex-boyfriend who was convinced Elizabeth Mallow was being unfaithful to him.
Well, the bruises on the arms and torso possibly confirm Sonia's story about Paul bashing Elizabeth.
Confirms that she was physically abused, doesn't confirm by whom. What about this Ian Gunther character?
The man from upstairs, yep, checked out his alibi. He did turn up for work at midnight, as he said.
Yeah, according to his mother's doctor, he was on the phone at 9 o'clock when the victim first reported noises at the window.
That leaves the victim's ex-boyfriend without an alibi. Hello, hello. Paul, charged with assault. 12 months good behaviour bond.
That was 4 years ago.
Peter, there were bruises on Elizabeth Mallow's body that happened about the same time you left the flat. Do you know how they got there?
No.
Sonia Cameron says you beat Elizabeth, and that's why Elizabeth threw you out.
Oh, she would. Anything to cause me trouble.
But you didn't leave the flat on your own accord, did you, Pete?
Look, it just seemed easier to tell my mates I'd walked out on her. You can understand that, can't you?
Is it true that you hit Elizabeth after you found her having a drink with Ian Gunter?
No. Look, I lost my temper a few years ago. I got into a fight. Once.
And that was over your girlfriend at the time, wasn't it?
So? Look, I've never hit a woman in my life. I never would. You ask Vic, he can tell you. He helped me out. Got me involved in the gym. It taught me control.
Tell us about your relationship with Elizabeth Mallow, Peter.
It was going fine until Sonia Cameron broke us up. I loved Elizabeth.
Why would Sonia lie to us about you hitting Elizabeth?
Because she wanted Elizabeth herself.
Now this is what we found under the fingernail scrapings. It's latex.
Right, so we're looking at a grey latex mask.
Indeed.
You definitely need a hobby, Fizz.
Yes, we haven't isolated the type of mask yet, and there was no semen on the sheet, so that does go along with Imogen's findings.
What about the footprint outside the window?
Yes, the only clear print we found was police issue. Guess who? Constable Vic.
Penny.
Stupid clodhopper walked all over the area.
All right, what else have you got?
Well, nothing much. The murder was confined to the bedroom. Now, these scratches on the window were made by a metallic object. I'll tell you what, Hayden, you find me the object and I'll see if it matches the scratches.
All right.
So how long was Constable Panay at Elizabeth's the second time she called the police?
About 10 minutes.
Okay, so the police left her place at 11:10, having not seen anyone or any sign of anyone having tried to break in.
Uh-huh.
Yet Elizabeth's dead soon after they leave.
Yeah. You know, the killer had to be close by. Not only to make the scratching sounds on the window, but to know when Constable Plod and his mate had left the building.
They also had to be close enough to know that she didn't call the police that third time.
Hmm. When he finally broke in.
Now, how could they know that?
No, see... Elizabeth told Constable Panay that the noise was like nails on a blackboard.
Right.
Couldn't have been the shrubs. That's not it.
It would have to have been whatever the killer used, like metal.
Yeah. Which means that the first two calls weren't a false alarm. Someone really was trying to break in. But why would the killer bother to wear a mask if he knew that he was going to kill her?
Did they know that you didn't ring the police the third time?
Steve, the killer had to have been in the flat to know that she didn't ring the police. I think the killer was here all the time.
So you didn't look in here?
No, we didn't look in here. Well, there was no point. I mean, she reported a prowler outside. There was no sign of anyone breaking inside or having tried to.
Mm-hmm. Right. Just this way. Peter Poole tells us that you and he spend a lot of time together at the gym.
Yeah, we work out twice a week.
Mm-hmm. Are you aware of the fact that he hit Elizabeth Mallow?
No, he wouldn't.
A friend of hers says he did.
You're talking about Sonia Cameron? Yeah, that'd be right. Pete told me about her and Elizabeth. Poison.
Did you know Miss Mallow well, or are you just going on what your brother-in-law told you?
Oh, I just reckon some women give their blokes a lot of grief, that's all.
Yeah, right. Look, can you tell us your movements after you left here last night, Constable?
You're asking me for an alibi? Me and my partner went back to the station.
for the rest of your shift?
Oh, pretty well. I mean, I ducked out to get some takeaway for a few minutes.
And how long is a few minutes?
I don't know. 10, maybe 20. Look, if you're implying that I had anything to do
with it. All finished here.
Yeah.
All right, Constable, if you can think of anything else, you be sure to let us know, all right?
Dead moths and a bit of lint. Now, if I'd been able to get some cigarette butts, I would have been able to test the saliva after DNA, but there you go.
We're going to have to, Napoleon. They've given us no other choice.
I'm just going to have a quick word to Mrs. B.
Yeah, okay, good. Excuse me.
Can I have something?
This is my little boy, Alex. This is the lady detective I told you about.
Right, you do the plumbing around the flats.
Yeah.
Do you ever have access to your mother's keys?
No. Mum doesn't give her keys to anyone.
Right, and you're absolutely sure that you didn't let anyone into Elizabeth's flat the night she died? Not, Peter Poole, maybe?
If he said I did, he is a liar. Well, I was glad to see the last of him. Elizabeth was too good for him.
Right, and she didn't have anyone else in her life?
Certainly not.
Absolutely sure about that?
I'm sure.
Okay,
thank you. What's this all about?
Mr. Poole, thanks for coming back, sir. If you'd like to come through, we just have a couple of questions for you. Yesterday, after Elizabeth Mallow's body was found, you said you came back here to get a couple of things?
Yeah. Just a couple of CDs I'd left behind.
You didn't come back see if you'd left anything inside here, for instance. This is a funny thing. I just dropped off a racing guide to Mrs. B across the hall, but she said she already had one. One that you dropped off the very day that Elizabeth Mallow was murdered.
Yeah, it was just a habit, you know. Yeah. Nearly every Wednesday. I like the old stick, that's all. She sort of depended on me.
2 weeks after you leave this flat, you come all this way just to drop off a racing guide to a little old lady. Mrs. B said you left her flat at 6 o'clock when the 6 o'clock news came on. What'd you do then, Peter? Did you let yourself back in here? Did you wait inside the closet until Elizabeth Mallow came home?
No, it's not true. I...
No? What were you trying to do, Pete? Frighten her?
I just wanted to find out who she was seeing. I wanted to catch them together. So, I waited. She got home about 7:30. I heard her in the kitchen. I was waiting to see what she was going to do. Then, next thing I know, she's calling the police. I waited till she went into her room, and then I took off before the police got here.
But you came back after the police had left, didn't you?
No, I didn't come back. I didn't come back.
Okay. Mr. Poole, we'll need to get a formal statement from you at homicide.
I didn't kill her. I loved her. I hit her once, mate. I didn't kill her.
Okay, that's all right. Just take it easy.
You've got to believe me. I didn't kill her.
It's all right. Take it easy. Just take it easy.
I hid in the cupboard. That's all I did.
He's got a motive, Malcolm.
But you got nothing to arrest him.
He's admitted to bashing the girl.
Yeah, but he hasn't admitted to killing her. Look, you might be able to hold him on the break and end her, but you certainly can't hold him on murder.
Look, it can't be a coincidence that he was there the very night that Elizabeth Mallow was murdered. I'm sorry.
Yeah, but why would he leave the racing guide with Mrs. B if he was intending to kill Elizabeth? It'd have put him right at the crime scene.
Maybe he got too cocky. People say he's arrogant. And having a brother-in-law that's a cop can't hurt either.
He's not the only one who had access to a key. Mrs. Mahood's son could get his hands on one, and we've got to check out whether Sonia has a key too. She and Elizabeth were very close.
All right. I'm just not going to shut the book on him just yet. What are you doing? I thought you wanted to talk to Sonia about keys.
Yeah, I'll be right up. I see you found a key.
Elizabeth said her pipes were banging. I meant to have a look at them earlier. But hey, better late than never, huh? What? You want to watch an expert at work?
Do you know that you're not supposed to be in here?
Well, that's a pity. You know, I hate being pulled out when I'm halfway through a job.
Mr. Mahood, how well did you know Elizabeth?
She's always at work whenever I have to fix things.
Yeah, but you must have seen her around from time to time.
Maybe. And if your next question's going to be where was I the night she was murdered, ask me mum.
Alex was at home all night. We had some dinner, we watched some movies, and we both went to bed at 10 o'clock. If you want to ask some questions of my little boy, you ask in front of a lawyer. He has done nothing wrong.
Oh, I'm not suggesting that he has. It's just that, you told me that you could sleep through an earthquake, so I'm wondering how you can be so sure that Alex didn't go out that night.
If you're looking for Sonia, she'll be at work.
No, she didn't turn up to work today, Mrs. B.
Well, that's not like Sonia.
Huh?
Doesn't seem fair, does it?
What?
The young girl in the prime of life being taken so suddenly, while old biddies like me makes you truly appreciate the time you have left, Stevie.
Oh, I'm sure you've got plenty of time left, Mrs. B. What's in the notes?
Oh, body corporate.
Right.
Can't even change a light bulb without you inform everybody first.
All right. Mr. Gunther, look, I'm sorry to disturb you, but can you remember Peter Poole hanging around the flats the night that Elizabeth Mallow was murdered?
No, I told you, I didn't see anyone. Right. Please, I've got to get some sleep.
Okay.
Sorry, I can't be of any more help.
Right.
Any luck?
No, there's no sign of Sonia, and Mr. Gunter didn't see Peter Poole around on the night of the murder.
I want to get back to the office. I want to check on Alex Mahood, cleaners.
All right.
right out looking, two lengths to Mark's Glory, 900 out now, and the leader Radiant Light battling on the speed, a length final mix, followed in third position by Santor.
Thank you, Napoleon.
Dino's Palin, Mayday, Talk Time and King's Fan.
Come in, give us a chance.
Bobby's Buck, a length to right out looking, Mark's Glory is right out of the hunt.
Hello, dear.
Oh, Miss Lou, the cleaner, found the door open, came in, she was dead there on the floor.
Right, thanks.
Tessa, no sign of a forced entry, so she could have let her attacker in.
Or else the killer had a key.
You can cancel out Peter Poole. He's been talking to his solicitor ever since he left homicide.
Strangulation.
Any similarities with the way Elizabeth Mallow was killed?
Yes, circular bruising, thumb marks on the larynx, so she was strangled from the front.
Could it be the same person, Toots?
There's no sign of sexual interference here.
Why would somebody kill her? Maybe she knew something.
Oh, she would have told me. Unless she remembered something and confided in the wrong person.
Sonia.
Mrs. B was worried she didn't turn up for work today.
Sonia, it's Detective Hayden.
Sonia?
Tess?
Sonia, can you see any pills?
No, but if she drank this much alcohol, that'll put her out.
Yeah.
Hello?
Hello. What are you doing here?
It's all right, it's okay.
I think we should get you into bed.
Yeah, come on.
I'll do it.
Okay, all right. Gently. She's fine. She's sleeping it off.
When are you people going to do something about this? Two murders in as many days. Who'd want to kill an old lady?
We're doing everything we can, Mr. Gunter.
You know, Fisk said that there were no signs of forced entry in Mrs. B's flat. Alex Mahood has access to the keys.
I was up a flaming ladder until half an hour ago. I had some guttering and look at round the back.
Okay. So you didn't see anybody standing outside Mrs. Beattie's front door or window?
When you're up a 50-foot ladder, you don't start looking down to see who's coming and going.
Okay, all right. Do you mind if we have a look inside your vehicle, Mr. Mahood?
No. Yeah, hang on. What for?
We know you have access to your mother's keys to the flats in this building.
Hey, look. I don't have to answer these questions. I want a witness. Where's me mum?
Dear Sonia, I'm going to cut back the shrubs from around our windows. We have all that gardening equipment in the shed, and I reckon it's time we stopped quibbling about the greenery and put our safety first.
You know, I hate being pulled out when I'm halfway through a job.
She wanted Elizabeth herself.
Peter beat her up. I told her to get rid of you.
Look, Constable Panay looked at
me. I told you already. I didn't see anyone, I didn't hear anyone, nothing.
All right. Where are you going, Tess?
The shed.
See, look at this.
Mr. Gunter.
Stupid old cow! Going on about the tools?
in the shed. I had to shut her up, didn't I? Otherwise she would have found out about the shears in the end.
You didn't have to kill her. Mrs. B didn't know any...
You're all the same, aren't you? Oh, Elizabeth, to beat me. You see, she was happy to cry on my shoulder about a fake boyfriend. But that was all. I wasn't good enough.
I wonder why. Now, just get him out.
But I just wanted to show her. I just wanted to frighten her. You see, I didn't want to do it. I just wanted to... Just
you all right?
I didn't mean to kill her.
Let's get over there.
Yeah, Tessa, it's easy. I can manage the phone and the shares at the same time.
Gunter could speak to his mother's doctor at the same time as he was terrifying Elizabeth, scratching on the window. The first couple of times that he made the noise with the shears, it was just to spook her, to make her hesitate before she called the police a third time. That's when he actually did break in.
But how could he be certain she didn't call the police a third time?
Easy, listen. See, he had to make sure that she wouldn't hear him when he finally did break in. So he waited until she was in the shower. He could hear the pipes banging from his flat upstairs.
So he was on to the fact that Mrs. Beattie's complaints about the bushes could lead us to the garden shed.
Yeah, and to him as the killer.
Should be. Look what you've done to my suit. Come on, take it on.
Like I said before, it's an old lock. You should get it checked out. Anyway, it's probably just shrubs scraping against the window.
No, it wasn't like that. Both times it was a screeching sound, like someone's scraping their fingernails across the blackboard. Did you check outside?
Yes, like the first time you called, no sign of anyone.
I know someone was trying to get in. It wasn't just the wind. I'm not an idiot. I know what I heard.
living alone, you know, windy nights, things rattle. It's easy to get all kinds of things in your head. We get lots of calls from lonely women.
I'm not lonely.
Look, if I was you, just go back inside, put the music on, and just take your mind off the wind.
The defendant then made admissions relating to the death of his partner, Joshua Green. He was charged with the offence of murder, bail was refused, and he will remain in custody until his appearance in court. Did I leave anything out?
Thanks.
I'll drop you home.
Okay. Oh, no.
You two look like hell.
Not enough hours in the day, sir.
That's not a plug for overtime.
It is, would I get it?
Nope. Victim's name? Elizabeth Mallow. Age 25.
Father?
Maria Mahood, the cleaner.
Morning.
Morning.
What have you got for us, Fisk?
Well, there are two broken fingernails. However, there is something under the index fingernail of the right hand. It's too dark for skin. Some other substance.
Yes, I'll see you get a scraping at the autopsy, Lance.
Imogen?
Any idea how she died,
Tuts? Yes. Possible strangulation, judging by the contusions to the neck and the hemorrhaging to the eyes. Circular bruising indicates that it was manual.
What?
Sexual assault. Given the bruising to the genital area, I'd say there's every probability.
Is this how the killer got in, Fisk?
Yes, that lock's been forced from the outside. Also, there are scratches on the glass there. The killer has definitely entered and exited through that window. Okay.
Do you have an approximate time of death?
Yes, you're looking at sometime before 2 a.m. She's been dead 6 to 8 hours.
Sergeant, I've finished in here. You want me to whip outside?
Yes, whip out and I'll join you, Constable.
Cleaner let herself in at 8, found the body and called the local police.
So, was the front door open, unlocked, when you came in this morning, Mrs. Broad?
I have a key. The door was locked, as it always is. Elizabeth was very careful about things like that.
And did you touch anything when you came in?
I put the kettle on. I usually like to have a cup of tea before I start work. Mm-hmm. As I waited for the water to boil, I went to Elizabeth's bedroom. I like to air the flat while I work. Her door was closed. I found her on the bed. First, I thought she had slept in, just didn't see me. I'm a heavy sleeper myself. Could sleep through an earthquake, my little boy says.
And how long have you been Miss Mallow's cleaner?
I'm not a cleaner. I am a manager. Something goes wrong with the flat, they call me and I see about the maintenance. I helped Elizabeth out now and then, that's all.
How long have you helped her out?
2 years. Sweet girl. Very polite. Worked very hard in real estate. Said she wanted to make it to the top.
What I wouldn't give for a cigarette. Been on duty 15 hours straight. I was just about to knock off when we got this call. Could have knocked me over with a feather.
Right. This your first homicide?
No, the victim called me and my partner in twice last night.
She what?
Yeah, she reported a prowler outside her bedroom window.
Hang on. You're telling me you were here last night twice?
9:15 and then at 11. But we checked the place out thoroughly. I mean, there was no sign of anyone. We checked it out inside and out.
What about the bedroom window?
The lock was faulty. It rattled in the wind. I told her she should get it checked out.
Great. I don't suppose you suggested to her she should go and stay with a friend or someone can come and stay with her.
She just needed reassurance. That's what I gave her. She was the hysterical type, easily spooked, you know.
Look, Constable, Elizabeth Mallow is dead, strangled. I think she had every right to be hysterical, don't you?
I'm going to have a look outside.
Righto. Well, it's only a partial footprint, unfortunately. Could have been one of the local constables. They were scratching around here last night.
Why were they doing that?
Elizabeth Mallow called them twice before she was murdered. She reported a scratching sound on the window, but there was no indication anyone had been around.
Well, the third time there was. Why didn't she call then?
Well, maybe she didn't hear anything on the third time.
Still doesn't make the local boys look good, does it? I'll get on to their commander about that.
Right.
Listen, you two, check out around the back.
Okay.
I wouldn't want to be in that constable's shoes.
Me either. I wonder why Elizabeth Mallow didn't call the police on the third time.
Well, maybe she didn't get a chance to. Or maybe she didn't want to look stupid in case it wasn't a false alarm.
Oh, come on. Fear is a much stronger emotion than embarrassment.
Mallow, not always.
What? You'd rather face a murderer and look stupid than admit it was a false alarm?
No, but I have a gun and I'm assuming Elizabeth Mallow didn't.
Look, Constable Panay looked in here and they said they didn't find anything, no?
Maybe they were afraid of spiders and didn't look closely enough.
Yeah, well, more likely just sloppy police work. Yeah. Come on, let's go. I'm Detective Steve Hayden from Homicide. May I have a word to you?
Paul Holmes!
Sit. I hope you're not one of these mumbling types. I don't hear so well as I used to. And you young people speak English like it was a second language.
Did you know Elizabeth Mallow well, Mrs. Beattie?
There's no need to shout. I'm not that deaf. And call me Mrs. B, everyone else does. Look, I warned them all. I told them something would happen if those shrubs weren't cut back. Anybody could hide in there and you'd never know.
Do you know anyone who might want to kill Elizabeth Mallow, Mrs. B?
No. Nice girl. Always a smile. Always a hello. She didn't have much time to chat, though. Rush, rush, rush. I kept telling her, slow down. There are more things in life than work. But why she never married young Pete, I'll never know.
Pete? Mrs. B?
Peter Poole. Elizabeth's boyfriend. They live together. Oh, poor boy. He must be heartbroken.
He's not living there now, Mrs. B.
But of course he is. I should know. He brings in my racing guide nearly every Wednesday. Comes in for a cuppa. He leaves work earlier than Elizabeth, and he fills in a bit of time with me until she gets home. Both like a bit of a flutter.
This Mr. Poole, do you know where he works?
Well, he's a salesman of some sort. I mean, he doesn't know.
Mrs. B, did you hear any noises last night, about 11 o'clock?
No, never heard a thing. I'll tell you who might know where Pete works. Sonia Cameron. She lives upstairs in number 3. She's a friend of Elizabeth's. They work together. Best of friends, like most opposites, I suppose. Pete should have told me he'd moved.
You sure it's Elizabeth?
I'm afraid so. Were you home last night, Mr. Gunter?
Up until 11:20, that's when I leave for work. I'm the night manager at St. Martin's Hotel, midnight to 7.
Right, and you didn't notice anyone hanging around the flats when you left for work last night?
No, but I did hear someone downstairs at about 11. Voices, but I didn't take much notice. Poor Elizabeth, I can't believe it.
What about 9 o'clock last night? Did you see or hear anyone then?
No, I was on the phone. I ring my mother's doctor that time every night, and she lives up north, and she never tells me how she's doing, so I give him a call.
Could you give me his number, please? We really need to check everything. Thanks. So did you know Elizabeth well?
Well, not that well. She was nice. We had drinks together a couple of times. I know her boyfriend moved out a couple of weeks ago, but apart from that...
Her boyfriend?
Peter Poole, arrogant sort of bloke. Always thought he was better than everyone else. Although he was jealous of me having a drink with Elizabeth. Although Sonia next door, she'd know more about that. But she'd be at work by now.
My God, what are you telling me? Where are they taking her?
You can't go in there, mates. We have to keep it secured. The homicide are finished with it. It's a crime scene.
Mr. Poole?
What am I going to do, Vic? Elizabeth can't be dead.
Whoa.
She can't.
You two know each other?
He's my brother-in-law.
Mr. Poole, your brother-in-law, Constable Panay.
Vic? Yeah, he's married to my sister.
Did he know Elizabeth?
Yeah, he'd met her.
If you hadn't broken us up, I would have been there to look
after. Back off!
Throw away the
camera! Back off!
Sonia Cameron, he killed her. He killed my best friend.
She should never have let Peter move in with her. I warned her. He was a pig. She should have got rid of him earlier.
So she didn't own the flat with Peter?
They get the money. He was a second-rate salesman. Elizabeth earned 3 times as much as he did. Another thing for him to be jealous about.
I should have been there. If I'd been there, this wouldn't have happened.
Well, maybe. When did you move out of Elizabeth Mallow's flat, Peter?
2 weeks ago.
Why?
I'd had enough.
Of what?
I hardly ever saw her. Just too... wrapped up in her work. Dinner with clients and working every weekend. And she was becoming neurotic.
In what way neurotic?
Nervy. Jumpy always. Snapping at me.
He was always accusing her of playing around when she wasn't like that. Elizabeth never looked at another man. I mean, men were attracted to her. Of course, she's beautiful. Successful, fun. Men were always making passes, but she never played around, no matter what he might tell you.
What were you doing back at the flat today, Peter?
I'd left some things behind. I wanted to get them back. I knew Elizabeth would be at work. I didn't want a scene, you know?
How did you plan to get in? Did you keep a key to the flat after you moved out?
I would have asked the cleaner, Maria, to let me in.
Right. Where were you last night?
I went out for dinner by myself. And then I went for a walk. I was back home by 10:30. I didn't go out again.
Can anyone confirm that?
Why don't you check where Sonia Cameron was?
Elizabeth left work around 7:15 last night. We were going to see a movie together, but she said she was sick, so I went on my own. I should have gone home instead, maybe.
What time did you get home?
About midnight.
And did you notice anyone when you got home, a strange car parked?
Did you try to find out how she was? No, she let me down.
But she was ill.
Elizabeth got a headache every time she had to deal with something emotional.
And she was emotional last night?
Apparently. I don't know, it was very complicated.
How long had you known Elizabeth?
3 years. I told her about the flat being for sale. It was a goodbye. She'd almost paid it off, too.
You said before that she should have got rid of her boyfriend, Peter, earlier. Why?
I thought you knew. I mean, you have arrested him, haven't you?
No, we haven't arrested anyone yet.
Peter found Elizabeth having a drink with Ian Gunther, from upstairs. They were just having a drink, for God's sake, and Peter beat her up. I told her to get rid of him. They only have to hit a woman once. Once. That's just the start of it. A basher never changes. They just get worse.
She suffered severe bruising to her upper arms, but not on the night she was murdered. I'd estimate they're a couple of weeks old. Several more bruises to the torso, also a couple of weeks old.
That confirms Sonia's accusation that Peter Poole was violent.
As to the night of her death, she was sexually assaulted, but there's no trace of semen.
Ooh, could the killer have used a condom?
Deeper bruising internally would suggest that the penetration wasn't penile. More than likely, it was manual.
So far, we've got two people accusing each other of murder.
What about motive?
Nothing yet.
The nature of the assault could indicate that the killer was sexually dysfunctional. Now, he may have broken into the flat with the intention of raping her, but could not perform.
Someone like an ex-boyfriend who was convinced Elizabeth Mallow was being unfaithful to him.
Well, the bruises on the arms and torso possibly confirm Sonia's story about Paul bashing Elizabeth.
Confirms that she was physically abused, doesn't confirm by whom. What about this Ian Gunther character?
The man from upstairs? Yep, checked out his alibi. He did turn up for work at midnight, as he said.
Yeah, according to his mother's doctor, he was on the phone at 9 o'clock when the victim first reported noises at the window.
That leaves the victim's ex-boyfriend without an alibi. Hello, hello. Paul, charged with assault. 12 months good behaviour bond.
That was 4 years ago.
Peter, there were bruises on Elizabeth Mallow's body that happened about the same time you left the flat. Do you know how they got there?
No.
Sonia Cameron says you beat Elizabeth, and that's why Elizabeth threw you out.
Oh, she would. Anything to cause me trouble.
But you didn't leave the flat on your own accord, did you, Pete?
Look, it just seemed easier to tell my mates I'd walked out on her. You can understand that, can't you?
Is it true that you hit Elizabeth after you found her having a drink with Ian Gunther?
No. Look, I lost my temper a few years ago. I got into a fight. Once.
And that was over your girlfriend at the time, wasn't it?
So? Look, I'd never hit a woman in my life. I never would. You ask Vic, he can tell you. He helped me out. Got me involved in the gym. It taught me control.
Tell us about your relationship with Elizabeth Mallow, Peter.
It was going fine until Sonia Cameron broke us up. I loved Elizabeth.
Why would Sonia lie to us about you hitting Elizabeth?
Because she wanted Elizabeth herself.
Now this is what we found under the fingernail scrapings. It's latex.
Right, so we're looking at a grey latex mask.
Mask, indeed.
You definitely need a hobby, Fizz.
Yes, we haven't isolated the type of mask yet, and there was no semen on the sheet, so that does go along with Imogen's findings.
What about the footprint outside the window?
Yes, the only clear print we found was police issue. Guess who? Constable Vic.
Penny.
Stupid clodhopper walked all over the area.
All right, what else have you got?
Well, nothing much. The murder was confined to the bedroom. Now, these scratches on the window were made by a metallic object. I'll tell you what, Hayden, you find me the object and I'll see if it matches the scratches.
All right.
So how long was Constable Panay at Elizabeth's the second time she called the police?
About 10 minutes.
Okay, so the police left her place at 11:10, having not seen anyone or any sign of anyone having tried to break in. Uh-huh. Yet Elizabeth's dead soon after they leave.
Yeah. You know, the killer had to be close by. Not only to make the scratching sounds on the window, but to know when Constable Plod and his mate had left the building.
They also had to be close enough to know that she didn't call the police that third time.
When he finally broke in.
Now, how could they know that?
No, see... Elizabeth told Constable Panay that the noise was like nails on a blackboard.
Right.
Couldn't have been the shrubs. That's not it.
It would have to have been whatever the killer used, like metal.
Yeah. Which means that the first two calls weren't a false alarm. Someone really was trying to break in. But why would the killer bother to wear a mask if he knew that he was going to kill her? Did they know that you didn't ring the police the third time? Steve, the killer had to have been in the flat to know that she didn't ring the police. I think the killer was here all the time.
So you didn't look in here?
No, we didn't look in here. Well, there was no point. I mean, she reported a prowler outside. There was no sign of anyone breaking inside or having tried to.
Mm-hmm. Right. Just this way. Peter Poole tells us that you and he spend a lot of time together at the gym.
Yeah, we work out twice a week.
Mm-hmm. Are you aware of the fact that he hit Elizabeth Mallow?
No, he wouldn't.
A friend of hers says he did.
You're talking about Sonia Cameron? Yeah, that'd be right. Pete told me about her and Elizabeth. Poison.
Did you know Miss Mallow well, or are you just going on what your brother-in-law told you?
Oh, I just reckon some women give their blokes a lot of grief, that's all.
Yeah, right. Look, can you tell us your movements after you left here last night, Constable?
You're asking me for an alibi? Me and my partner went back to the station.
For the rest of your shift?
Oh, pretty well. I mean, I ducked out to get some takeaway for a few minutes.
And how long is a few minutes?
I don't know. 10, maybe 20? Look, if you're implying that I had anything to do with
it. All finished here.
All right, Constable, if you can think of anything else, you be sure to let us know, all right?
Dead moths and a bit of lint. Now, if I'd been able to get some cigarette butts, I would have been able to test the saliva after DNA, but there you go.
they won't do it, we're going to have to, Napoleon. They've given us no other choice.
I'm just going to have a quick word to Mrs. B.
Yeah, okay, good. Excuse me.
Can I have something?
This is my little boy, Alex. This is the lady detective I told you about.
Right, you do the plumbing around the flats.
Yeah.
Do you ever have access to your mother's keys?
No. Mum doesn't give her keys to anyone.
Right, and you're absolutely sure that you didn't let anyone into Elizabeth's flat the night she died? Not, Peter Poole, maybe?
If he said I did, he is a liar. Well, I was glad to see the last of him. Elizabeth was too good for him.
Right, and she didn't have anyone else in her life?
Certainly not.
Absolutely sure about that?
I'm sure.
Okay, thank you.
What's this all about?
Mr. Poole, thanks for coming back, sir. If you'd like to come through, we just have a couple of questions for you. Yesterday, after Elizabeth Mallow's body was found, you said you came back here to get a couple of things?
Yeah. Just a couple of CDs I'd left behind.
You didn't come back see if you'd left anything inside here, for instance. This is a funny thing. I just dropped off a racing guide to Mrs. B across the hall, but she said she already had one. One that you dropped off the very day that Elizabeth Mallow was murdered.
Yeah, it was just a habit, you know. Yeah. Nearly every Wednesday. I like the old stick, that's all. She sort of depended on me.
2 weeks after you leave this flat, you come all this way just to drop off a racing guide to a little old lady. Mrs. B said you left her flat at 6 o'clock when the 6 o'clock news came on. What'd you do then, Peter? Did you let yourself back in here? Did you wait inside the closet until Elizabeth Mallow came home?
No, it's not true.
What were you trying to do, Pete? Frighten her?
I just wanted to find out who she was seeing. I wanted to catch them together. So, I waited. She got home about 7:30. I heard her in the kitchen. I was waiting to see what she was going to do. Then, the next thing I know, she's calling the police. I waited till she went into her room, and then I took off before the police got here.
But you came back after the police had left, didn't you?
No, I didn't come back. I didn't come back.
Okay. Mr. Poole, we'll need to get a formal statement from you at homicide.
I didn't kill her. I loved her.
Yeah, I understand. It's all right.
I hit her once, maybe. I didn't kill her.
Okay, that's all right. Just take it easy.
You've got to believe me. I didn't kill her.
It's all right. Take it easy. Just take it easy.
I hid in the cupboard. It's all I did.